May I request Dr. Srinivas, Dr. Prasanna, and Dr. Kumaran to come occupy the dais. So before starting the session, let me introduce the illustrious panelist. Dr. Prasanna is an intensivist. He is one of those very accurate to the diagnosis intensivist, doesn't kind of do everything just like that. He's one person who thinks about the diagnosis, Dr. Prasanna. Then from the ID side, Dr. Vidya and Dr. Subramanyam, you've heard them, and Subra doesn't stop talking anytime, even on dais. Then Dr. Kumaran. Dr. Kumaran is a general surgeon and a surgical gastroenterologist. He works at Apollo First Med Hospitals. You can say that he runs the show there. Give him any complicated case, any time of the day or night, he is there. He has full control over the entire staff. He makes sure things happen. It's not like if you give him something, things happen. Then Dr. Srinivasan. Dr. Srinivasan is a Stanleyan. He is a professor from Ramachandra Hospitals, SRMC. Very dynamic, young at heart, I would say, and extremely to the point. Let's start off. So we'll start with the scenario and start with the discussion afterwards. Now, this is a patient referred across to us. A middle-aged gentleman, all these are real-life scenarios. I've not taken any hypothetical cases. A middle-aged gentleman is referred across for further management of pancreatitis. Remember, he is walking to your OPD. He has not come in a wheelchair or a stretcher. He comes to the OPD walking. He's got history of 3 months of pain, abdominal pain. He had an acute abdominal pain 3 months back, which stayed for a week or so. And then he started feeling better, went home. He was diagnosed with pancreatitis. Subsequently, there's on and off pain, significant weight loss. Now, for the last 6 weeks, he's been having on and off fever. Overall, he's lost around 25 kgs of weight. And he's been put on n number of antibiotics. By the time he decided to come to us, he came all the way from Bangalore. Now, this guy has a diagnosed pancreatitis 3 months back. Now, the question to the physician is, somebody comes with pancreatitis. Somebody comes with abdominal pain to the emergency in the middle of the night. So the ER person does amylase, lipase, imaging, and says it's some ultrasound and say it's acute pancreatitis. At that time, can you say it is the cause is an infection or not? Dr. Srinivasan. Kindly make it as brief as possible because we just have 15 minutes per session. So one panelist will not repeat the other panelist words. Yes.
Now, generally infection in acute pancreatitis, usually they come around the second week, the 8th, 9th or 10th day. The infection generally associated with acute pancreatitis are pneumonia or a bronchopneumonia, bacteremia. Usually it happens in patients with pancreatitis who have a necrotizing pancreatitis. The first 2 weeks, this is what usually happens. If somebody comes with a fever 3-4 weeks, then possibility of a surgical cause of fever should be ruled out.
So do you want anything to add more, Dr. Prasanna? He said acute pancreatitis, generally it is not with a bacterial infection. Do you see bacterial infection with acute pancreatitis anytime?
Only in immunocompromised patients like HIV, and then diabetic, uncontrolled diabetic patients, we come across bacteriological infections.
So what he's saying is somebody comes with a structural problem or somebody has a pancreatitis secondary to an intra-abdominal infection, that's when you have an acute infective cause. If he's otherwise stable, infection cannot be a cause for acute pancreatitis. In other words, acute pancreatitis presents with infective syndrome-like picture, but a bacterial infection is seldom a cause for acute pancreatitis. Now, in this scenario, what is the role of antibiotics in acute pancreatitis? Vidya.
In acute pancreatitis, I would not really look at antibiotics. I mean, probably at the point when the patient is developing an abscess is when I would really think of after source reduction is when I would really.
But there's a controversial point. Patients come to you sick with fever, probably with site elevation of kidney function, may require some oxygen. In such a kind of patient, can you get away without giving antibiotics? Subra. I think most of you people must be thinking that. That's what happens in clinical practice.
Yeah.
So somebody comes in sick, can you get away without giving antibiotics?
Practically, no. Ideally, yes, but practically, no. very often I call it meropenem deficiency disorder or imipenem deficiency disorder or meropenem replacement to a problem, something like that. See, that's what happens, you know, because very often there's this pressure because pancreatitis is a very severe infection which causes multi-system involvement. There is loss of fluid volume, there is renal dysfunction, electrolyte dysfunction, sugars go haywire, a lot of things happen. And to make the call that there is no sepsis is not always easy. In the first week, like was has been mentioned again and again, in the first week, you do not expect the patient going into sepsis unless it's a catastrophic event or it is a post situation, like somebody's had surgery, somebody's had something else. Yeah, that kind of pancreatitis, you can have early infections. But otherwise, you do not get bacterial infections that early. So routinely using antibiotics only selects out for more resistant bacteria and causes more headaches on the back end. Now in this situation, for this particular patient, it's already like 5 weeks of 6 weeks of all kinds
no,
of...
No. We'll stop at
okay,
this.
We'll just talk
so
about this.
So the point taken is, somebody comes with acute pancreatitis, Kumaran wants to add.
I just want to add a point in this discussion. If somebody has had an intervention like an ERCP-induced pancreatitis, then you're looking at the possibility of cholangitis in addition. So if it's a fresh case of pancreatitis and if they're not sick enough to go to an ICU setting, then certainly there's no role for antibiotics. In an ICU setting, whether you like it or not, whether the patient is infected or not, we tend to give infections to them. So I suppose, you know, putting in catheters, this and that, they are very high risk for developing infection. So yes, but in the ward, no.
So the point taken is, if somebody comes with a syndrome, please send off blood cultures at least initially. It doesn't matter if you start antibiotics, but once the patient stabilizes by 48 to 72 hours, when your cultures are back, think twice about continuing the antibiotics. Now, back,
one more
please.
Thing. And the first few days or first few hours, fluid management is more important than adding an antibiotic in acute pancreatitis. First 2 days, how much fluid you rush into the patient will save the patient.
Yes, please, Doc.
If it is a necrotizing pancreatitis, probably you would definitely, there's a role for antibiotics, even though you don't have evidence of any acute infection. You can prophylactically give carbapenems in a patient with necrotizing pancreatitis.
We'll have a discussion on that later while we're coming to this patient. Now, back to this patient. This patient had a slightly increased counts, 12,000. Now, remember, this patient has come back after almost 3 months of an acute event. 3 months back, he had a pancreatitis and there's probably a lingering pancreatitis on because of his abdominal pain. But he's been having fever for the last 5 weeks. And then, but he walks to your OPD, looks fairly fine, comfortable. His total counts are elevated, neutrophilic. LFT is slightly altered. PTINR seems to be okay. RFT is normal. Extra urine routine is normal. The surprising point is amylase lipase seems to be relatively okay. Is that okay, Dr. RK? Patient basically has fever spikes, no appetite, and a vague abdominal discomfort.
This is not an atypical situation at all. This is, see, there are, very briefly, there are two issues with these patients. One is you have mortalities only in two phases with pancreatitis. It is generally within the first 2 weeks, which is because of multi-organ dysfunction. Patient crashes in ICU, not because of infective complications, but because the systems are failing. The second peak of mortality is after the 6th week, usually. That is because of infections in the pancreas. Now, the amylase lipase will usually be elevated only on admission, meaning the first initial presentation. You cannot expect to have a raised amylase lipase in a patient who's lingering with issues. And it is very rare that you actually have a raised amylase lipase unless you kind of take a fluid from a collection from alongside the peripancreatic region. That may have a raised amylase, but not in the blood usually.
So basically, a normal amylase or relatively slightly elevated amylase lipase does not rule out a lingering problem in pancreatitis in a patient who's had acute pancreatitis 3 months back. That's basically the point. Now, how to approach the fever now, Dr. Srinivasan?
Now, it is almost 5 weeks since a patient had an acute pancreatitis.
3 months.
3 months. Now, basically, I would think of surgical causes of the cause of persistent fever. Probably an infected pseudocyst of the pancreas, something like that. That will be how I would go about it.
So basically, and would you like to add anything, Vidya?
think that's what we have to look at. We have to.
So basically, both of them are thinking in terms of something happening in the pancreas. Do remember, you can have some other problem with a cause. With there is with an episode of pancreatitis 3 months back. Look into the source first. Wherever it started, look into that area first. Now, so when do you think of an infection with somebody with an established pancreatitis? Somebody has had a diagnosis of pancreatitis in the ICU, kind of recovering, but not yet ready to go to the ward. When do you think of an infection?
It is usually not in the first 2 weeks. Okay, generally, pancreas and infections, it usually happens when you have necrotizing pancreatitis. Necrotizing pancreatitis is a diagnosis which you normally tend to make on CT. It is usually a CT finding. If you have patches of pancreas which are not in lighting up with contrast, then the patient has got necrotizing pancreatitis. You can have other markers which kind of give a hint, you know, very raised CRP in the first 48 hours. If you have a patient who's got issues in terms of stability, that may give you a hint, but does not diagnose necrotizing pancreatitis. Necrotizing pancreatitis, to get the diagnosis, you are supposed to wait for a week to 10 days before you do a CT. So CT after the initial admission may be normal. For it to be clear, if you have a clear area of demarcation where there is no contrast enhancing the pancreas, that usually takes a while. So if you have a CT in the second week after admission, if there are areas where there is necrosis, and from there on, if you start having a patient who's behaving funnily in terms of fever and so on and so forth, then you start thinking of infections in the pancreas. Until that point, if you the fever is because of other causes or a systemic inflammatory response.
Now, like if they come in that, what investigation would you do?
Usual bloods, the cultures, and mainly CT. CT is the golden rule.
Which is better, CT or MRI?
CT with contrast, the pancreatic protocol will give you the best answer.
Right. Now, this is where we stood. We had a CT taken. If you can look into it clearly, you have an area of, well, the marker is working. So you have some areas where there is. That's an easier. So you have an area. It's better. So this area you see some necrotic areas with some air pockets. So basically, this guy has got pancreatitis, significant necrosis, and there seems to be some air pockets. It's a pancreatic abscess. He's post-ERCP.
So there is a stent in the CBD.
Yes. I forgot to add that he had a ERCP 3-4 days before coming to us. I didn't put this ERCP thing because it didn't happen before. So he's been having fever. They just wanted a source reduction. They went ahead, did an ERCP. Subsequently, they came to us with a pancreatic abscess. He's already been on multiple antibiotics. Now, this is going to, there's an abscess now. So what are the management issues? Dr. Kumaran, will you open him up immediately?
The collection has to be drained. Whether we open it up or whether we do it minimally invasive, that's an entirely different issue. That is the source of sepsis. It has to be drained. If there is not much in terms of necrotic tissue which has to be removed, and if it's a well-circumscribed lesion which is infected, then minimal invasive drainage of the collection will suffice, provided you keep that catheter in place and keep washing it out. If it's a more generalized phenomenon, if you've got an emphysematous collection where there is air pockets within a big phlegmonitis peripancreatic collection, then you probably would require to do a necrosectomy at the same time. That will usually entail doing an open, or if you're skilled enough, a laparoscopic surgery.
Now, wouldn't antibiotics suffice, Vidya or Sup?
And if you have an abscess, the treatment is source reduction, and antibiotics is not going to like clear out your pus. So you source reduce and rationalize your antibiotics based on your culture. So that's what is going to work.
Now, Dr. Prasanna, these people have said, I'm going to take it out, I'm going to clean it up. So what's the problem you're anticipating? He's going to land up in your ICU.
Yes, madam. I will put the patient on an imipenem-like antibiotic because it will have somewhat, other than the antibiotics, it will have good penetration into the pancreatic wall, and also metronidazole also it has a good penetration. But anyhow, with the we have to get the aspiration of the abscess and go for gram staining and culture.
What I'm asking is, after surgery, do you anticipate any major problem? Do you see mortality in these patients? A patient looking well, coming to us, we do something, do they die after that?
No, mortality is very, very low. Once we are aspirating and necrosectoming the patient.
So basically the problem is some of them, especially early on with the disease, if they develop, if you go for an intervention, the pancreatitis flare up maybe quite a bit. That's what's our strength. This patient has been there for 3 months, so probably mortality is going down very dramatically because everything is kind of settled and circumscribed. We discussed that. Now the next is the catchment points over here. Anybody comes with fever, always try to find the source. In this patient, they placed a pigtail. The drainage was not complete, it was incomplete. Pus cultures grew a ESBL E. coli. He required 8 weeks of IV antibiotics. He had etapenem. The effervescence immediately started. As soon as they drained as much as possible, fever settled down. Clinical improvement with regards to increasing in intake and weight gain started after 2 weeks. By 8 weeks, he's relatively okay. He's now off all these things. He's had a cholecystectomy, doing very well. Now, learning points here. Antibiotics do not enter pus. Pus has to be drained. Empirical broad-spectrum antibiotic leads to resistant infections. So a lot of times what happens in these kind of patients, as soon as they come with a pancreatitis, they started on a carbapenem. And it goes on and on, they recover. And then by the time they come with an abscess, it's usually a resistant bug. Now I'm coming to the most pivotal discussion. In a necrotizing pancreatitis, patient has had a pancreatitis, settled a week later. Somebody decides to do a CT after 2 weeks. This often happens. Patient is comfortable, and then a CT is done, there is necrosis. Patient is comfortable with no fever, but still feeling weak, not able to take food much. Now, do you give empirical antibiotics for necrotizing pancreatitis without an abscess? Subra. This is a $100 question. Most of you must have seen it. You would have discharged the patient, you'll come back after 2 weeks with a CT scan saying that there is necrosis. Now, will you put him on antibiotics?
In real life, everybody gets antibiotics.
Now, what is ideal?
I think we need to look at the data based on which this recommendation for antibiotics for necrotizing pancreatitis came up. It's not using antibiotics willy-nilly for everybody. It should be, you should target your patients appropriately. Not all necrotizing pancreatitis behave the same way. We have necrotizing pancreatitis who actually are recovering very well and who are actually doing well. And there are necrotizing pancreatitis who are on their way to forming a pseudopancreatic cyst and pancreatic abscess and stuff like that. Distinction of that clinically can be a challenge. So giving everybody an antibiotic when they are not yet infected does not necessarily mean they're going to get better. And second, also remember that, like Vijayalakshmi just mentioned, I think this is a very, very important point. You do select out for drug-resistant bacteria. If and when they do get subsequently infected, it's going to be a carbapenemase producer, which makes treatment even more difficult. So antibiotics are not necessarily a good answer. They are an answer, but not necessarily the best answer.
So he has confused you further. So if there are no features of infection, now Subra, Kumaran.
Correct me if I'm wrong. If a patient is not an ICU, which is what you said, you're almost talking about OP here. There is no role for antibiotics at all. Right?
Thank you.
There is no role for antibiotics at all. If this happens very often. It depends on who the patient is seeing. If you're seeing me, meaning a surgeon, definitely no antibiotics. Right? If it is with the, I may sound politically not correct here. If it is a physician, quite often they end up with IV antibiotics. Now that is because the perception is very different. If you have a patient who's not got overt signs of sepsis, necrosis per se does not matter. Does not matter at all. These patients do not have to be on antibiotics. I have seen these patients. I have followed these patients up. That does not matter at all. The same patient in ICU who's continuing to be sick, that is a different scenario. This scenario where he walks into his OPD, he is as good as any FSC, does not require antibiotics.
Dr. Srinivasan, you want to add something? I brought up this controversial point just for this.
Now, somebody coming to the OPD is very comfortable, no antibiotics accepted. Somebody is in the ICU, sick, yes, antibiotics accepted. But let's talk to the middle road. Somebody comes, diagnosis pancreatitis, admitted because he is vomiting, is dehydrated, and all that. You take a CT scan on the second or third day, you find almost one third or more than one third necrotized pancreatitis. Will you give antibiotic or not?
All right.
Will be into this scenario often. What would you say? He's saying somebody comes in, gets admitted, slightly dehydrated, immediately they'll put them into your ICU. Patient will be relatively stable. You can check the patient out the next day. He comes to you in the evening. Would you start him on antibiotics then?
In case of acute pancreatitis.
Not acute. He's saying that acute and then goes home and comes back.
No. In hospital.
See, one gets admitted to the ICU, one gets treated as an OPD, the middle road where the patient is admitted to the ward.
Oh.
In the ward. Third day, you take a CT scan, is found he's got necrotizing pancreatitis. Will you put him on an antibiotic or not? He's reasonably stable.
Not necessary at all. We can observe the patient. We can repeat the CT scan after 15 days or 2 weeks also.
Yeah.
Because all the abscesses are not infected. Some of the abscesses are sterile. We can just observe and we can, once the patient goes for sepsis or if he has persistent fever, leukocytosis, elevated CRP, like that, no, you have to put him on antibiotic and plan for early intervention.
May not be a panelist, but I'll just sum it up. So basically the choices, if they're going to be very stable, acute pancreatitis, no problem, no antibiotics. If they are sick, no problem, start them on antibiotics, decide upon the culture and the clinical picture. Middle road patient, if they come in when you are not sure what is happening, no problem, start on a broad spectrum antibiotic. By 48 hours, your CT will show you some necrosis. You will know somebody with a necrosed or infected pancreatic abscess is not going to become all right within 48 hours. The patient is showing a significant improvement once you correct the hemodynamics, because most of the time they come in with dehydration. They don't eat much. Then your cultures are negative. There's not much of a fever. Forget, the counts will be elevated. Doesn't matter because it's only 1 week or 10 days. Stop the antibiotics. At least de-escalate to something simpler. Because in necrosed patient, what happens? The necrotic area is the bed for any kind of infection to occur. Only necrosed area becomes an abscess. If you give a broad spectrum antibiotic, the abscess will be with resistant bug. If you don't give a broad spectrum antibiotic, if he develops abscess, it will be sensitive. So you cannot really choose out which patient is going to become abscess, which patient is going to develop an abscess, which patient is not. So let's not use broad spectrum antibiotic empirically unless we have definite evidence of infection. Am I clear? Right. So.
We keep hearing that imipenem is the best drug of choice. Now, if you're saying don't start them on carbapenems, then what would you recommend?
See, a point is, when they come in, a BLBLI is more than enough. If the patient, when patient lands up in ICU, extremely sick, no problem. Comes from the community, when you're not sure, relatively stable in the ward, go for a BLBLI. And the patient is like, patient is improving, then try to stop early. I would go for a BLBLI if the patient is not very sick. No, hemodynamically stable. Right? Change of roles here. So next scenario, any further questions, we'll take it at the end of the session. Now, very simple scenario. Elderly male comes with fever and cough for 5 days, no URI symptoms, past history, he is an alcoholic who stopped some 5 years back, not 5 years, 2 years I guess. He's got a chronic compensated liver disease, surgery for an RT for a CA tongue 1 year back, completely in remission, in fact a relative of mine. So it's been history of fever and cough for 5 days. So 2 days into fever, he goes to a local doctor. This GP starts him on Levoflox 250 OD. Generally people start 500. I think he must have started on 250 because of his liver problems. So there must have been a gut instinct. He said, like, you take a CBC and x-ray, if the symptoms persist, come back to me within 48 hours. So by then, this relative decided that he'll see me. So next day morning, he comes to me with a total count of 13,500 with 80% neutrophil and platelets of 90,000. I'm very sorry, I couldn't find his x-ray. So I've just put something across. It was even vaguer than this. There wasn't a very clear consolidation. Some vague haziness. I told him to get admitted. But he coolly went home, was sick throughout the night. Next day, around 10 a.m., he gets admitted. Now, with this picture of 5 days of fever and then neutrophilia and a vague x-ray showing some vague patch and platelets of 90,000, what will be the treatment plan now?
Immunocompetent,
I forgot to tell you. No, alcoholic, chronic liver disease.
He's not an alcoholic now. Surgery 1 year back. Mm-hmm. Would you pull that as, let me clarify that, whether it is immunocompetent or immunocompromised?
I would say any chronic liver disease patient, you should take it as immunocompromised.
Okay, fine.
And especially when you have see a tongue radiation, the worry is also about aspiration. It's only 1 year.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
This guy will come under the high risk category. Yeah.
This surgery in RT and CA tongue, you had said, yeah, I mean, if I had
1 year seen back.
1 year back one and year then back. On remission, on no chemotherapy.
No, at the point of time, no chemo.
Now he's got a chronic compensated liver disease also. So if you are going to label him as a immunocompromised person, and then the next point will be whether, does he need an admission or not? First, let's go through the normal CURB 65. And if you feel that he requires admission, and an immunocompromised person, whom you feel that patient admission is required, is quite stable. Now, we would probably start him on ceftriaxone, 2 gram, along with the doxycycline or azithromycin. That will be my choice. Or I will go up on a levofloxacin 750 milligram IVOD, if he is stable enough to be put in the ward.
Okay. Would you think of a BLBLI here in this patient? Because this, everything is borderline.
Probably.
See, that's it. So no problem. The initial choice of antibiotic doesn't matter at all. Make sure you cover the spectrum. You can always de-escalate after 48 to 72 hours. See, even all of us have so much of confusion about what to start. There is no uniform single answer. Now, at admission the next day, this is how the x-ray looked. Not his x-ray. He had an effusion. One side, there was definite effusion. By then, he was quite toxic. He was a bit dehydrated. Because of cost issues, he landed up at a small hospital. His BP was borderline low and he was tachycardic, which the system didn't recognize immediately. So this was his x-ray with a patch now. Now, what are the possible organisms? What will be the antibiotic?
This patient looks like, 65-year-old with a CAP syndrome or a community-acquired pneumonia syndrome with thrombocytopenia. So pneumonia syndrome with thrombocytopenia, it could be sepsis thrombocytopenia or atypical bug with thrombocytopenia, or probably the thrombocytopenia could be secondary to the underlying CLD. But for all practical purposes, I think this patient requires probably a BLBLI with an atypical coverage would be my antibiotics of choice. So what are the organisms I would be targeting in this patient? I would probably cover pneumococci, I would cover ESBLs definitely. I would also cover for atypicals like scrub or mycoplasma, etc. Although, single unilateral lobar patch with effusion is unlikely, but still, I think I would still cover these. So ESBLs, pneumococci, staph, and atypical bugs coverage would be prudent in this patient.
Do you want to add anything, Subhra?
I would get a gram stain immediately.
Okay.
This would be pending cultures. Blood cultures, sputum culture will definitely mandate.
A gram stain, a good expectorated gram stain is the poor man's bronchoscopy. It's cheap, it's very easy to do, and has a very rapid turnaround time. All you need is a decent microbiology setup. You don't need a fantastic microbiology setup. Anybody can do a gram stain. And the gram stain, in many cases, will tell you what the pathogen is. Atypicals, you will not find the pathogen. But if it's pneumococcus or staph, you are going to see it in this kind of a sputum. And that is immensely helpful. If you see a lot of neutrophils, you know it's a good quality sputum, and you find diplococci or cocci in pairs, you know it's pneumococcal pneumonia. And that is going to be tremendously useful. And I agree. If you see an effusion, it's less likely to be atypicals, more likely to be a typical pathogen. But yes, this is a sick patient you want to cover broad as far at the outset.
By evening, he became severely breathless, hypotensed. There was no urine output from midday. He entered the hospital somewhere around 10-11. He was shifted to the ICU, catheterized, intubated, required high flow oxygen, required a high PEEP. Inotropic requirements started going up. Total, by then they immediately collected the results. Total counts were 26,000, which if you remember 2 days back was 13,500. It has doubled. Platelets have down. RFT, LFT was altered. PT9R is altered. ABG shows severe hypoxemia, severe acidosis. Blood cultures, sputum cultures are awaited by then. Now, will this change the management in any way?
Now, since the patient is in severe sepsis, I would definitely step up the antibiotics. My first choice will be something like a meropenem or a piperazolam tazobactam or a cefepime, any one of these three. Plus, I would go for a gram-positive coverage, something like a Vanco. I would also try to cover the atypicals with a levofloxacin. If I'm suspecting pseudomonas, since the patient is in very severe sepsis, probably I will add a tobramycin or aminoglycoside to that.
So basically, when the patient is sick, no problem, you can add as many number of drugs as possible. You want to cover every bug. Now, would you think of anything else, Kumaran? As a surgeon, in a patient with... Okay, right, fine. There was, I asked this question for some other reason. The surgeon's approach is mildly different. Prasanna, then we'll come to ID last. Prasanna.
Since he is immunocompromised, we should not waste time. We should be immediately admitted, not as a OP basis.
He is admitted. By yes. Then he is admitted.
Is he have any signs of cysts from the day one?
Mm.
And how he is hydrated? Not only antibiotics. We should see a patient as a whole. Is he have any fever, tachypnea, and then leukocytosis or band forms like that, and then put him on a broad spectrum coverage, send, as rightly said, blood culture and urine culture. Once report come, you can escalate or de-escalate depending upon the blood culture and urine culture.
Now what I'm asking is, at this scenario, so patient is admitted and somebody who's on, probably the patient is put on piperacillin tazobactam with azithromycin. Now this kind of change happens and is shifted to the ICU. What's the main problem anticipated? What should the nurse do before shifting the patient immediately to the ICU?
No, mostly everything is done already.
Okay. Basically, yeah. Subra.
I think I'm comfortable using the port or the PSI score. One, because this patient would have actually scored very high on the score, which basically meant the patient should have been admitted first off. Second, there was actually a study which showed that such patients, it's better for them to go to the ICU and then be downscaled to the ward rather than go to the ward and upscale to the ICU, because mortality is higher if they go to the ward and then they have to move to the ICU. Because if they are in the ICU, they're more likely to be picked up early when they are deteriorating, and probably early goal-directed therapy can happen faster as compared to somebody staying in the ward, you know, crapping out and then move to the ICU. This guy obviously probably was pretty in distress, in significant duress when he was shifted to the ICU. Third is that making sure the first dose of antibiotic goes in as quickly as possible. Now, the time to administration of antibiotic is absolutely key when you have a septic shock, when you have an impending sepsis, septic shock situation. It really makes a difference to outcomes, especially mortality. And the last thing is, this guy also has a pleural effusion. I would definitely want to tap that to see if that's an empyema. Because if it's an empyema, then drainage of that is absolutely critical, because you don't want to have an infected bag of pus sitting over there without being addressed, because that can make outcomes really worse, even in spite of doing everything perfectly. So fluid hydration, making sure the guy gets enough oxygen, making sure that you start the antibiotic right at the word go. I agree, I would definitely add vancomycin because you want broad coverage, including staff. I would look at the gram stain. I would try and see if I can get a needle into the chest cavity of the significant fluid to see if it is pus. And I think this patient should go straight to the ICU right off the bat.
So basically what we're trying to say is he should have had the antibiotic. It's going to be goal-directed therapy now. Now repeat x-ray in the ICU. One whole side was white out, the other side was hazy. So it was a very fast progressive pneumonia. So ultrasound chest was done and there was an effusion. An ICD was placed. It was not frank pus. It was a turbid fluid which drained out. Now next day, by then this guy was on meropenem and vancomycin and azithromycin. I guess these three were the drugs we were given. So pleural fluid showed GPC in chains. Blood culture grew GPC. Patient passed away within 72 hours of admission. So basically he had a strep pneumonia. It was a pneumococcal pneumonia with septicemia and Imodius. The thing about pneumoconiosis is usually dies with a whiff of antibiotics. This guy probably, the antibiotic received was less and probably was too delayed. Now what exactly went wrong? Where could we have changed?
I'm going to say something. See, please understand that this is not because of pneumococcus which is drug resistant. This is not drug resistant pneumococcus. Drug resistant pneumococcus exists, but it's very, very, very rare. Right? Much, much less than 1% of our pneumococcus are drug resistant. This is what happens in drug sensitive, drug susceptible, actually, drug susceptible pneumococcus. It's not because of drug resistance. All the drugs that the patient received have excellent activity against pneumococcus. I'll continue that after a little
while. Would you like to add some, when patient comes to the OPD, like your gut instinct definitely helps, and would you like to add something else for them to think about admitting the patient? We see most of our patients will have financial constraints, but if you think a patient is sick, better to admit than to lose them.
No, basically this patient walked into the OP. Now, I really don't see any idea or any reason why we should be straightly admitted to the ICU.
They're talking about the second day, not the first time.
Yeah, fine. Initially, he came quite stable, admitted in the ward, and probably the antibiotics of that at that point of time, the choice was reasonably good. And ceftriaxone plus an azithromycin, that would be reasonably fine. And once he became sick, I mean, if the antibiotics had been given on time and the right time early on, probably things would have been better. And still he deteriorated, probably we're looking at a resistant bug. And then...
It turned out to be a sensitive pneumococcal with a very low MIC.
Okay. So probably what went wrong? Probably we started the antibiotic late, and that's the reason why things went down bad. And once we shifted to the ICU, probably as we said, we must have gone for much broader coverage of antibiotics plus an ICD insertion to take off the MPMR, what was there. What all that was done fine, but unfortunately...
Probably a bit late.
A bit late.
Surgeon's perspective. Right, on the day one, the patient did not want to get admitted, which is quite common. Would it have been better? Would it have been better if he was put on IV antibiotics and sent home on day one?
Yes.
Because we know he's immunocompromised. We know he's a high-risk patient. If you kind of give them the best possible scenario where he can sit at home and possibly have decent antibiotic cover, would it have prevented him de-escalating?
Probably on day two, whatever the general practitioner did was not wrong. Probably could have given a higher dose. By the time he decided to call me up, I must have started him on IV antibiotics. I coolly didn't see him and ask him to get admitted. So my gut instinct was something was wrong. So that one day's delay cost his life. Probably that day, getting him in or starting on an IV antibiotic as an outpatient would have saved his life is what my gut instinct is. A very close relative of mine. But what happens, patient's mind is, they know they are sick, but they still keep on procrastinating. But since it's somebody I know, I didn't end up with a problem. Otherwise, immediately after an event occurs, they'll point their fingers at you and say, you didn't push us. We probably would have given a phone advice. But when your instinct says patient is sick, when you feel something is wrong, put your foot down. If you can't admit them, at least start on IV antibiotics, because the dose of the drug which reaches the bloodstream is probably the most important aspect in treating an infection. If enough dose of the drug does not reach in, it is not going to kill the bug, even if it's going to be a sensitive bug.
X-ray that was taken, you said it was quite hazy. It was
sorry,
not very,
the no, initial no, I'm just X-ray. Telling,
initially X-ray that was not very much convincing of a consolidation. Normally when patient is dehydrated or an evolving pneumonia is there, or a patient is neutropenic, you have to wait for some time to get a very classical X-ray picture. Probably that also tilted the balance to diagnosing a pneumonia.
Yes.
Definitely. A better option if initially...
There was a trial also which said that abroad that CT chest was much better than X-ray. Only problem is most of the times finance indicates most of our decisions, and that's where we get stuck. If it's an affordable patient, please go ahead with a CT. Now, would you want to add anything extra?
Yes, yeah. As sir rightly said, the patient should have been better admitted first day only in ICU, because where we can closely monitor him, everything, all the vital parameters, rather than admitting in ward.
Give the numbers on that. This is the port PSI score for this patient. Port PSI score for a 65-year-old male patient who has history of neoplastic disease and liver disease alone. I'm not going into the oxygenation. I'm not going into the counts. I'm not going into the heart rate. I'm not going into anything else. Just these factors alone, his score is 115 points, which puts him at class 4, not 1, not 2, not 3. So on day 1 itself, he was class 4, where the mortality is 8.2 to 9.3% on the first day, not the second day, the first day. And for this, hospitalization based, recommended based on risk. This is exactly why in the US at least, when we have patients coming in, definitely not in the OP, in the ER, things like this are automatically documented. We have algorithms which are set up so that patient's PSI and port are, or port and things like that, PSI score is automatically included in the decision-making algorithm, because initial disposition makes a huge difference. This patient should have got IV antibiotics, not levoflox. This patient is a very high-risk patient. He's had history of cancer recently, and he has liver disease, and he's an older patient. That itself is enough to say this patient needs to be, maybe not in the ICU, but he definitely needs to be on IV antibiotics in the hospital. Yes, sorry. Oh, we'll come to that. We'll come to that in a minute. You're right. We are coming to that. The point is that this is where I think these kind of predictive models are useful. Because when we tell a patient you need admission or you need a hospitalization, they're going to ask you, why do I need it? I'm walking around. I use these kind of things to tell them, listen, risk to your life is close to 10%. 1 in 10 people like you is going to die. Your choice. Your choice about being 1 in 10. Or 9 in 10, whichever it may be. I hope you're 9 in 10, but I don't decide that. The point is, there is good data to show what the outcomes are in these kind of situations. And if you go to day 2, where he had probably had fever. Oh, he had fever? He had fever. I'm sorry, I did not include that. So if you include fever, it comes to 130. It's going up and up. I'm sorry, as I start including more and more numbers, the score is going up and up. And the mortality keeps rising. This guy had to be in the hospital first day. Second day, he had to be in the ICU because this guy was really, really sick. This guy should have been in the ICU getting oligo-directed therapy, aggressive evaluation, and source correction. But in spite of that, the mortality is going to be high. See, when I say 8% and 9%, that is in spite of hospitalization. Without hospitalization, it's going to be even higher. In this case, it was 100%. He died. So, please do not underestimate how dangerous pneumonias are based on looking at how the patient is. Walking patient with pneumonia does not mean it's kosher. Pneumococcal pneumonia is a very, very, very aggressive disease. And this is another important point. Being drug susceptible does not mean it's okay. One of the most dangerous diseases known to us is necrotizing fasciitis.
Next session is that, so don't talk.
Okay. No, I'm talking about, okay, fine. I forgot. The point is that this is penicillin susceptible pneumococcus. Drug resistance and virulence of the organism are different things. It can be entirely drug susceptible, but can be extremely virulent, causing a lot of mortality, and that's what happened here. And the answer to virulence is either prevention or aggressive early management. And in this patient, on day one, it should be admission to the hospital. On day two, it should have been admission to the ICU. Anything other than that would not be as best quality of care as could be possible.
Preventive measures, Vidya.
Preventive measures, definitely. This patient qualifies for a pneumococcal vaccine. That's what I was wondering, what his vaccination history was. He was a chronic liver disease.
He was not vaccinated.
Yeah, so I think this definitely, there was a role for vaccination.
That's one major problem in low socioeconomic strata, because to cut the cost, the physician does not do few things, which kind of cost this guy's life. So basically, at the end of the point, a susceptible bug may be much more virulent than a resistant bug. So it's starting the correct antibiotic at the correct time. Early initiation of antibiotics saves life. Don't delay antibiotics. We've been talking about when the patient is sick, when you feel the patient is sick, start antibiotics immediately. You can de-escalate any time later. Give an adequate dose. Choose an antibiotic based upon the organism you assume. So in post-flu season, please think about pneumococci and staphylococci. So when you have a flu season, the next 3 to 6 months, you'll have a lot of patients coming with pneumococcal pneumonias, staphylococcal pneumonias and stuff. The immunocompromised, vaccinate. Finally, do remember, sensitive bugs are often much more virulent and they divide and kill rapidly. Thank you.
Shall I add one more point? Please use the pulse oximeter at OPD. It will throw a better light on oxygen saturation at room temperature. It will be very easy and cheap for poor resource sitting hospitals like we are in from suburban. Though he is walking into the room, if his room air oxygen saturation is less than 88%, he is more going for respiratory failure.
One more thing, for a poor man thing, you can do a 5-minute walk test. That's what I do routinely. If a patient comes to you, you're not sure whether the patient is sick or not, just ask him to walk for 5 minutes. End of 2-3 minutes, you know he's sick or not. This 5-minute walk test really helps. You require just a room of this size, or you make them walk in the corridor, you will know. Anybody becoming tachycardic, tachypneic, acute onset without any chronic problems, or somebody was stable before, he is sick.
2 quick points. One, nobody has ever seen a multidrug resistant Acinetobacter baumannii coming in from the community. We only see it as nosocomial infections because it's not a virulent organism. It's drug resistant, but it's not virulent. Pneumococcus, on the other hand, which is extremely drug sensitive, routinely causes community-acquired infections. So let's not confuse the two. The other point is, I contest this point about vaccination being expensive. Vaccinations are actually cost-saving. Why do I say that? Even if you don't develop a pneumonia, even if you develop one respiratory tract infection, what is the cost of a respiratory tract infection? At least 2 visits to a patient, to a doctor, his fees, your loss of livelihood, the blood testing, X-ray, when you bundle it all together, it is significantly more expensive than one dose of the vaccine. And the second point is there data to show this? If you look at the Canadian data, because where the Canadian government pays for healthcare, every year they give flu vaccine and the pneumococcal vaccine for the for those who are above 65 and above. For every dollar that they spend on the flu vaccine campaign, the system saves $45. Can you think of a place where you go and give 1 rupee and they give you 45 rupees in return? Flu vaccine campaign. Pneumococcal vaccine campaign, the return is $8 for every dollar spent. So is it cost saving? Absolutely. Do we see it? We are blind.
Right. We'll go to the next scenario. This is a middle-aged diabetic. He comes, he's brought with history of fever for 1 week. He was treated for UTI with norfloxacin 5 days back. He's been on norflox for 5 days, 1 week of fever with urinary symptoms. His sugars has not been well controlled. His symptoms are very hazy. He's drowsy, arousable, tachycardic. BP is low when he comes in, slightly tachypneic. Systems are otherwise non-contributory. So immediately you worry about UTI, you catheterize, 100 ml of turbid urine gets drained. Diagnosis.
A diabetic, uncontrolled fever, was on antibiotic, comes with low BP, slightly drowsy, probably he's in sepsis, UTI with sepsis, probably I'll think of pyelonephritis.
Now he's already on antibiotic for 5 days.
Yeah. The antibiotic that he's got is something like norfloxacin, fluoroquinolone. Commonly we think of, in a diabetic patient or normally UTI, we think of an E. coli, which is ESBL. So probably the norflox has not worked. So this patient is in sepsis and has already been treated with norflox. I would put it as a pyelonephritis. You'd probably say secondary to E. coli, ESBL. I would start him on carbapenem straight away.
Right. So sugars are high, counts are high, creatinine is high. LFT is relatively normal. He's got mild hypoxia, requires some oxygen. Urine ketones are negative, cultures are sent. As what antibiotic in ER? He said a carbapenem, now ID person, intensivist.
Imipenem is better. We can use
what happened to you?
He said imipenem, carbapenem. Carbapenem.
Mm. What happened to the urine gram stain?
Urine gram stain is not going to come in the middle of the night. And oh, you're not sitting in global hospitals. So obviously you're not going to get the gram stain.
I think, you know, I miss those days. Like Dr. O.C.
No
used
stories,
to say.
Subra.
Dr.
To
O.C.
point.
Used to say, when he was a PG, apparently they used to have the back room in the ward itself where they have a microscope. They go do the gram stain themselves. you know, you want to know if it's gram-positive or gram-negative. Because if it turns out that this is enterococcus, your meropenem is not the best choice. And it's a 2-minute test. It costs nothing. I don't know. I mean, see, the problem is things which are cheap and very useful will never be used. Yes or no? Let's be honest. I'm standing for election. Vote for me. Anyway.
Then what will be your choice, Subra?
No, carbapenems are very reasonable because there's data to show that if you've had a recent quinolone failure, you're selecting out for an ESBI. Whether you want to use a BLBLI or a carbapenem can be discussed for many, many different reasons. Personally, upfront, I would use a carbapenem and then de-escalate once I know better. But I think carbapenems are absolutely acceptable option here.
And now, the next question is imimiro or erta? Imimiro.
Well, you don't use erta in these kind of situations. Why? Because it's extensively protein bound and therefore ertapenem is not a drug you'd use in a patient who's going into septic shock. Ertapenem is a lovely drug for urinary tract infection. If you have a if you have a patient with pyelonephritis and is uncomplicated, patient has got fever and whatnot, but not in septic shock requiring ICU. Now there, ertapenem is a nice choice, nothing wrong with that. But when you have a septic, here the problem is not the kidney infection. Here the problem is the whole body is septic. The patient is dying. That's not the situation where ertapenem is to be used. Ertapenem is to be used for stable patients, not for patients who are intensely unstable. This is an unstable patient. Therefore, your choice would be class 1 carbapenems, which is either IMI or MERO.
Now, IMI, MERO or BLBLI. What about cefepirazine, sulbactam and piperazole-intazobactam?
I was going to say
now
amikacin.
Now you know why I called you.
I was going to say amikacin, but fine.
You can add that. Now, that was the next question.
Absolutely. I'd love to use amikacin in this situation. Why? Because amikacin kills like nobody's business.
Creator 4.5 still okay?
The first dose of aminoglycoside, irrespective of who the patient is, free of nephrotoxicity. Every nephrologist will tell you that the first dose of aminoglycoside never hurts the kidney. You have 1 day free. The first dose, give the full dose. If you're using amikacin 15 mg per kg in 100 ml normal saline over 1 hour, it does not matter. It will not do anything to your kidney. The first dose, it's not free of cost, but it's free of toxicity. It does not cause any nephrotoxicity. The first dose is free. So you've got 24 hours to decide what to do. I always love giving aminoglycosides. I mean, one dose of amikacin upfront mainly because one, it's reasonably cheap. And two, it is very, very powerfully effective. It has got very good concentrations in the renal parenchyma, not in the urine, but in the renal parenchyma, it has excellent concentrations. And your bloodstream levels are astronomical. And it has got a huge, what we call post-antibiotic effect. So it kills and then it continues to kill for many, many hours after that. So it's a lovely drug that way.
And BLBLI with a carbapenem. Vidya.
Probably looking at the inoculum effect. Okay, there are a lot of studies to still say BLBLIs and carbapenems are almost the same. But I think, okay, taking into inoculum effect at this point in such a patient, I would still stick to carbapenems probably till the patient stabilizes and then probably go in for a BLBLI once the patient is stable.
Thank you.
Now, which carbapenem to use? If I'm really looking at a point to cover enterococcus, maybe imipenem would cover an AMP-sensitive enterococcus. So probably imipenem.
Then, with fluid bolus, BP picks up. So overnight in ICU, cost issues, morning he gets shifted, or overnight in ER shifted to the ward. He was given a shot of vancomycin, meropenem 500 BD. Is that okay? Any controversies with this? Any comments on that? Night, as soon as he comes in, he gets one shot of meropenem 500 mg, creatos 4.5, and vanco 1 gram. Do you want to add anything on this?
No, I never give 500. The loading dose of all antibiotics is creat independent. Please understand that the first dose of antibiotic is to saturate the system. So you give the full dose, whether it's colistin, whether it's meropenem, whether it's amikacin. See, please understand, let's say you got a patient with chronic renal failure who requires aminoglycoside. The first dose is still a full dose. 500 mg is not a full dose for an adult. If you had given 1 gram upfront and then adjusted renal doses, that may be understandable. But it has to be a full dose upfront because otherwise you don't get enough blood levels. If you don't have enough blood levels, you're not going to kill the bacteria. Please do not adjust the first dose. The first dose is a full dose irrespective of what the kidney function is. That is very, very important.
What he said for amikacin also stands for vancomycin. So even if it's going to be nephrotoxic, first dose. Now, Vidya, we'll talk about this.
1 gram.
Next question is, they've been talk about this 2 gram for septicemic illness and hypotension. What's your comment on that? Do you want to give a higher dose in patients like this or stop with 1 gram? There are some PGs, so we have to satisfy them. We don't have a choice.
See, the recommended dose I would still say would be 1 gram, but I think there is a lot of issues in distribution of the antibiotics in case of sepsis. So there are studies coming up with a higher dose of antibiotics.
But still no concrete
but
proof.
I think there is still no concrete proof, so I would still stick with the normal dosing of carbapenems, which is meropenem with 1 gram IV etale.
I'd go further than that and say, see, please understand, when you're adjusting the for renal dose, you're using a chronic kidney disease model. And this is acute renal failure. And in this patient, there is actually hyperfiltration.
We are coming to this next, so don't talk about it.
No, see, this is exactly why I like aminoglycosides. No junjet.
Right. The urine culture grows a ESBL E. coli. What is to be done to the antibiotics now? We are not talking about the need for de-escalation. That concept is already over. We are going to de-escalate. It's an ESBL E. coli. What would you choose now? He's on meropenem. You stopped vancomycin after the first dose. By then, you got the cultures. Now, you want to de-escalate from meropenem. Drug of choice. What would you do? In your setup, whatever you want.
I would still continue with carbapenem.
Carbapenem. Kumaran, you don't treat, so we leave it. Dr. Prasanna?
I treat.
He cuts. He cuts. We treat. He cuts. We treat.
Those are uncontrolled. I will stick on with imipenem only.
So, both the physician intensivist wants to stick on with imipenem.
We spoke about pyelonephritis, right? Now, was there any imaging which confirmed it?
No, we're coming to that.
No, but that would decide whether you're going to de-escalate or not.
No, it is not done till now. See, cost issues are there. This is a real-life scenario.
Before the imaging.
Hold on. What about an ultrasound?
Ultrasound was done on the day he came in. So that showed a residual urine. This was done in the ER itself, and they inserted a catheter. So that ultrasound showed relatively this guy was obese. So according to the ultrasound, there was a urine and there was no. Yes, he got it. So, and then you remember his creat is high, so everybody is worried about giving a contrast. And then there was discussion about cost issues and also whether a plain CT will help or not. So CT is not yet done. His urine culture has grown ESBL E. coli. It's 48 hours. Blood cultures have not grown anything. So now urine culture has come. 72 hours, no culture growth. Urine culture has grown ESBL E. coli. So what antibiotics? The physician intensivists say they're going to continue on carbapenem. Now back to ID people.
Go ahead.
So blood cultures are negative, urine culture, ESBL, E. coli. No imaging yet.
There is a problem here in that, by definition, this is a complicated urinary tract infection. Every male UTI is complicated. It just doesn't matter what it is.
Creat is high, so complicated.
Yeah, whatever. And the point is that we have to look for structural abnormalities because it's a male UTI. Men don't get UTI. So it's either a prostate or a stone or something like that.
Uncontrolled sugar is also there.
True, but uncontrolled sugars does not cause pyelonephritis. May increase the risk. We are looking for an obstruction. If there is concern for an obstruction and therefore inoculum effect, then there's a concern. But in general, if you have an abscess, you tend to be bacteremic. The fact that you're not bacteremic makes the probability of an abscess lower, point number one. Two, if there's a large enough abscess, the ultrasound would pick it up. A small abscess may be missed. But a large enough abscess, your ultrasound may pick it up. You may say, you know what, body habit is really crappy and I can't see. But at least if they can say that there is no pelvic helical dilatation, it doesn't look like it's ballooned out, there's no focal collection, and the blood cultures are negative, and the patient is stabilizing 48 hours, it may be okay to de-escalate. I don't see a problem with that. Having said that, would I blame everybody who doesn't de-escalate because they're worried they want to get the CT? I mean, I can't say that's wrong. I would say, try and de-escalate.
Next question is, at this point of time, when the culture is being negative and patients BP picked up and normalized the next day, ertapenem will be a cheaper option. Can you go down to ertapenem?
Ertapenem is fine. Definitely.
Definitely not the broader carbapenems. You have to prevent collateral damage. You don't need a non-fermenter cover at this point. You have to at least de-escalate to ertapenem.
Remember, when patient comes in hypertension, it is not a good choice, but otherwise, for a community-acquired urinary tract infection, etapenem is the drug of choice. So at this point of time, de-escalating with etapenem is a good option. Now,
gentler on the patient's wallet.
Right. Now, the patient is in the ward. He is relatively okay, but the family says he is confused on and off. There's a low-grade persisting fever, 101, 102, then goes down to 99, 98. There's some fever on and off. Urine output has increased. It's around 500 to 800 ml, not completely normalized, but it's not totally anuric. Sugar under decent control, so immediately think about electrolytes are normal. Creatinine levels. At admission, 4.5, next day, that's night he comes in, next day it's 5.2, goes down to 4.4, still 4.5. This is day 5. Now, primary physician wants to escalate the antibiotic. He's been de-escalated to etapenem. He wants to de-escalate back to meropenem and teicoplanin. Is that enough? Is it rational, or you want something else?
This patient looks like he's confused. His creatinine is going up. Looks like there's an obstructed system. So what I would want to know is there an obstruction? So I want some urology.
The primary physician says there could be something wrong. It could be a resistant bug. It's an ESBL E. coli. Are we rational in bringing it down to etapenem, or it could be wrong?
I'm completely rational in bringing it down to etapenem. What I would want to know at this point is if there is an obstruction in the system.
Yes.
In which case, these antibiotics are not going to give you any benefit.
So basically, everybody agrees about ruling out a structural cause now. So I'm really sorry. I'm a demented old soul. I don't collect pictures properly. Again, it's not this patient's picture. This is a real life scenario. He had a mild emphysematous pyelonephritis. No, this is a textbook picture. So sorry. So you see, the whole kidney is ballooned out. They would have picked it up. And remember, but most of our patients are obese when they are middle-aged, and our ultrasound technicians may not be good. Our doctors may not be sometimes good. So think twice. There may be a structural problem. So stent was placed. Upper tract specimen calls for culture because the primary physician had a doubt about the urine culture initially. As soon as the stent was placed, immediately the next day patient became afebrile. Urine output, creatinine improved the very next day. So learning points, always send blood cultures, because management of a septicemic illness differs quite a bit from non-septicemic illness. Start antibiotics early. Don't forget the golden hours. Source reduction is very, very, very important in sepsis. Please always de-escalate. Now, case scenario is a bit complicated. I think we have 5 more minutes or 10 minutes. 5 minutes, we'll finish off. Now, this is a gentleman who was transferred from an outside hospital. He was in an outside hospital for quite some time. History goes this way. He went to sleep quite well. He noticed a swelling in the leg the next day. He's a farmer, but he was not sleeping outside. He's sleeping inside the house. So he goes to the hospital with a leg swelling. He was started on with meropenem and vancomycin. They thought about snake bite, etc., etc. He was on meropenem and vancomycin for 6 days, and then he came to us. He was unconscious, required inotropes, had to be put on a ventilator, no urine output at all. This is how his legs looked. Actually, Kumaran's patients, some 5 years back, I think. So, diagnosis, necrotizing fasciitis. So, we won't go in. We'll just discuss ID part and finish it off. Counts were elevated, hemoglobin is low, platelets is low, PTIN are altered, creat is elevated. So basically, it's an MODS, multi-organ dysfunction syndrome secondary to sepsis. Now, again, we will not talk about this. Now, the question is, would you want to debride now or later? Physician, I'm coming to you later. Sorry, Gavaniklia. No. Necrotizing fasciitis with patient in multi-organ dysfunction. So everybody agreed on necrotizing fasciitis. He has come to you after 6 days, but alive. He has survived till 6 days because of the antibiotics. Multi-organ failure, platelets of only 10,000. He is admitted under you, not under Kumaran. Would you want Kumaran to operate on him or not?
Yeah, definitely.
And what is the problem you anticipate, Dr. Prasanna? Would debridement now? Because the traditional dictum, the anesthetist will come and say, not fit for surgery, and go off. What do you do then? No, Kumaran has a good control over his anesthetist. Most of us don't have. So anesthetist will say, not fit for surgery. Then, will you be able to improve these parameters?
we can give platelet transfusion and take for wound debridement.
So please remember, certain times your antibiotics or wait watch doesn't work. You will have to go put them on platelets, and then probably you have to go for surgery. All of us agree. If there's disagreement, we'll discuss later. Now, what antibiotic will you choose now? Already he's been on meropenem and vancomycin, has come with MODS, looks very sick, has been in a hospital for 6 days in an ICU. What antibiotics, why?
I remember Dr. Jack Sobel.
No time
this.
For stories.
No.
Antibiotic
I'll tell
names.
You what he said. He said this patient doesn't need infectious disease, he needs a chaplain.
Now tell me the antibiotic. He survived with us for 20 days.
This is a culture medium. It's a dead, rotten tissue, which is a perfect culture medium. And you have selected out for extremely hardy, extremely drug-resistant pathogens. So you would probably go for something like colistin-based therapy and a lot of prayer.
And probably, would you want to add antifungals too?
Yeah.
Probably, yes.
Yes. Okay, so wound was debrided on... Actually, I had even given some more drugs. I had covered for stuff which you probably don't hear, like Elizabeth Kingy and Stenotrophomonas, etc., etc. Under a very broad cover with a lot of blood products, he was debrided. The tissue grew a pan-resistant Acinetobacter. An X-ray also showed a patch. An ET aspirate grew a Candida and Acinetobacter. Now, are the cultures consistent with the clinical picture? Remember, it is an acute onset skin soft tissue infection. He acquired it from the community. This guy is immunocompetent, and it was rapidly progressing. So would you think in terms of necrotizing fasciitis, or do you want to change your diagnosis? Srini, he's your patient.
Not my patient.
Surgeon's patient.
Prasanna. He will transfer the case to CC, the critical care group. All these are real life cases.
No, on seeing the picture, it's a totally blank out. rightly said, we have to choose the fourth thing, prayer. And escape from the back door.
Okay, now.
This is a culture medium.
What I'm asking is your diagnosis still necrotizing fasciitis or not? Now, we have two types of necrotizing phases. One from the community with streptococci, another with multiple organs put together. More of a synergistic gangrene kind of a picture. Would you change your diagnosis to... multi-bug type 1 necrotizing fasciitis rather than a streptococcal type 2. Would you change that?
No.
It's got a pan-resistant bug.
No, this is not like a funius. It's not a synergistic necrotizing fasciitis. Necrotizing fasciitis is a clinical diagnosis. Microbiology is not your primary method of diagnosing necrotizing fasciitis. I'm very happy about this diagnosis, mainly because this still tells us that our clinical skills are relevant and we don't depend on the lab to tell us what to do. The lab guides us in what to do. But if our job is going to get outsourced to labs and Google, we are all going to be in jeopardy. Our jobs are going to be gone very soon. This is a clinical diagnosis. Necrotizing fasciitis should be suspected clinically and aggressively debrided. Now, finding pan-resistant bacteria basically means it's been allowed to be a culture medium and therefore things are growing. And to me, the Acinetobacter is a good marker of the previous hospital's microbiology. Their endemic organism is a pan-resistant Acinetobacter baumannii is what I know. That's all it means. It doesn't mean that the patient came in with like I said earlier, you don't come in with Acinetobacter baumannii from the community. It's a nosocomial pathogen. I'm not talking about all Acinetobacters, I'm talking about Acinetobacter baumannii. That is a nosocomial organism. And therefore, that was picked up at the previous hospital. Infection control needs to be better, but more importantly, the leg needs to be debrided.
So basically, they should have cut him out. They didn't cut, they let him. So probably streptococci got replaced by Acinetobacter. And patient, somehow he needed to spend some more money, so he survived for quite some time. So basically, with a lot of products, Kumaran cut it out repeatedly. He stayed with us for 10, 15 days, no? Yes, he forgot the patient totally. He succumbed. We couldn't do much. But he was with us for at least 2 weeks, if I remember correctly. Learning point, source reduction. Antibiotics do not absorb dead tissue. Antibiotics do not absorb pus. Broad spectrum antibiotics can select in for resistant bugs. De-escalation limits the emergence of resistance. So make sure you debride, make sure you give the right drugs. Thank you. Summarizing again the same thing.
Quick point. Necrotizing fasciitis, if you remember the picture, go back to the picture now. There is actually necrotizing fasciitis going up his trunk as well. Yeah. It is not the leg alone. Yes. You have to remember that. If you have doubt in a clinical situation, all you have to do is put in a needle. You will know what it is. If you hitting blood, then that is viable. Quite often you'll hit just serous fluid or a dark colored fluid. All that has to go. Yeah. Right? So if he presumably had the similar kind of looking leg when he was in another hospital and it was missed. If your index of suspicion is high, put in a needle.
Thank you. That's all time. Thank you. That's all the time we have. Questions can be taken up later. We'll go on for the microbiology session. Thank you.
Me, who had a who was sick 10 days back, but she managed to come over here. She coordinate everything, so they deserve a huge applause.